What's up, MBL? This is Timeout. I'm your host, Gibbs, and this is the second episode of our weekly MBL radio show. Welcome. This is going to be all about keeping you up to date with what's going on around the MBL, trades, free agent pickups, rivalries, and all sorts of MBL news and gossip going around the league, of course, with my own take on things. So sit back, relax, and enjoy whatever it is you're doing, and let's get into it. With our first time out, let's head over to Cincinnati and discuss the trade between the Bengals and the Panthers for quarterback Will Grier. Will Grier was drafted in the third round out of West Virginia by the Panthers. Not many had high hopes for the young quarterback, but with the Bengals in desperate need of one, they began talks with the Panthers prior to the draft. In the beginning, the Bengals offered their second round pick for Grier, I believe it would have been around the 44th overall pick in that draft. The Panthers told us that they were hesitant to move Grier at first, with Cam getting older, and they felt they could develop Grier. So the Panthers countered with a second and a third rounder, which the Bengals denied. And then they countered again with a second and a fourth rounder. But the Bengals denied that offer as well. The Bengals didn't want to give up that much at the time, and they felt they could pick up a quarterback in the draft. The Bengals, however, whiffed on a quarterback in the draft, and were going to be forced to start Easton Stick out of North Dakota State. After the first preseason game with Stick at quarterback, the Bengals went back into talks for Grier from the Panthers. So the Bengals returned with the same offer of a second rounder for Grier, and I'm pretty sure the Panthers owner was a little offended. His words to me were, "Oh no, he didn't." So of course, the price is going to go up. The Panthers countered with a first rounder or two second rounders in season 42 MBL draft. The Bengals accepted the first. Now, talking with Brad, in his mind, after going 7-9 the season before, he felt confident that with Grier at the helm, he could make it to 10 wins. As we all know, that was not the case. The Bengals went 3-13 their first year with Grier, and that first round pick became the second overall pick in season 42 draft. So let's get into some of Grier's stats in MBL season 41, where the Bengals went 3-13. Grier threw 227 passes out of 370 for a 61% completion rating, 3,857 yards, 23 touchdowns, 32 interceptions, and was sacked 57 times. A lot of yards, but also a lot of interceptions. So far in the MBL season 42, Grier has 6 wins and has thrown 128 of 208 passes, a 61% completion rating, for 1,932 yards, 14 touchdowns, and 14 interceptions, and has been sacked 26 times. Of his 6 wins, 5 have come against teams with losing records. I think the Bengals have a chance, if they stick with Grier, to continue to develop him and build pieces around him. Grier has a young team with only 2 players over the age of 30, AJ Green and Geno Atkins, who are both 33 and likely out the door soon. So Grier has worked out okay-ish for the Bengals for now. Now, what did the Panthers do with the second overall pick? They drafted left guard BJ Wagner out of Florida, a very solid lineman. So far this season, he has played in only 2 games and only 7 downs played. The Panthers told us they are developing the 21-year-old this season, and they plan he will become full-time starter in MBL season 43. Wagner will definitely help shore up the Panthers' offensive line for the rest of the cycle. Now it's time to decide who got the better of this trade. Do I think at the time of this trade, it was, and actually probably still is, an absolutely horrible trade for the Bengals to make? Yes. You should have just taken him for a second and a fourth rounder, but no. Had to try and wait it out for the draft, see how that worked out for you. Then you come back and insult the man with offering him just a second rounder for him again? Of course he's gonna make you pay. The Panthers shored up their offensive line for the rest of the cycle, and with a new quarterback who will likely be picked up in free agency or the draft since Cam is getting older now, not only did they get great value in the trade, but effectively used the draft pick to get a stud offensive lineman. On the other hand, maybe the Bengals got their quarterback of the future as well. They seem to like Grier, but I will like to see if in 2 seasons from now, if he's still even on the team. Let's see if the Bengals can develop Grier and turn a horrible trade into a decent franchise quarterback. All I can say to the Bengals owner is keep on trucking. Alright, what do you guys think of this trade? Let me know in the comments below. Alright, let's move on to our second time out of the day. I want to go over who is in the lead for the AFC and NFC Offensive Rookie of the Year and Defensive Rookie of the Year awards. These standings and stats are through week 12 with no games played yet. I'm going to go through all of them and their stats and discuss after. For the AFC Offensive Rookie of the Year race, we have in first place Chiefs wide receiver Ron Walters with 60 receptions, 1,179 yards, and 10 touchdowns. Jets halfback Harmon Bentley with 132 attempts, 637 yards, a 4.8 yard average, with 11 touchdowns and 26 receptions, 286 yards, 2 touchdowns. In third place, we have Steelers halfback Deontay Atkins with 123 attempts, 661 yards, a 5.4 yard average, and 8 touchdowns, also 24 receptions, 217 yards, and 1 touchdown. Next, we have Texans tight end Thomas Golston with 30 receptions, 519 yards, and 7 touchdowns. Then we have Texans again with halfback Terrion Matlock 97 attempts, 418 yards, a 4.3 yard average, 1 touchdown, 17 receptions, 165 yards, and 1 touchdown. Then we have Chargers wide receiver Eddie Miles with 35 receptions, 517 yards, and 5 touchdowns. Also has 4 rushing attempts for 27 yards. Then we have Bengals wide receiver Garrison Dale with 29 receptions, 400 yards, and 3 touchdowns. Chargers halfback LaMarcus Leary with 53 attempts, 248 yards, a 4.7 average, 3 touchdowns, also 9 receptions for 90 yards. Patriots Cortez Gresham with 25 receptions, 319 yards and 3 touchdowns. And in the final spot, Texans Brian Gibson with 11 receptions, 163 yards and 2 touchdowns. In the NFC Offensive Rookie of the Year race, we have Cardinals tight end Brian Ramirez with 47 receptions, 749 yards, 12 touchdowns. Then Eagles halfback Franklin Moore with 71 attempts, 484 yards, a 6.8 yard average, 9 touchdowns. Third, we have Packers wide receiver Tyrone Williams with 33 receptions, 542 yards, and 4 touchdowns. Then Bears quarterback Ian Leno with 108 of 174, a 62% completion rating, 1,442 yards, 6 touchdowns, 10 interceptions, has been sacked 36 times, also has 27 rushing attempts with 134 yards. Then we have Packers halfback Kyle McFarland with 24 attempts, 140 yards, a 5.8 yard average, 2 touchdowns, also 4 receptions for 72 yards and 1 touchdown. Then we have Lions quarterback Matt Dye, who has thrown 89 of 135 for a 65% completion rating, 1,219 yards, 7 touchdowns, 10 interceptions, and has been sacked 26 times. Then we have 49ers halfback Kobe Scott with 22 attempts, 220 yards, a 10 yard average, and 1 touchdown. Falcons wide receiver Clinton Dobbs with 12 receptions, 147 yards, and 2 touchdowns. Cowboys tight end Chandler Hollenbeck, 14 receptions, 152 yards, and 2 touchdowns. And bringing up the rear, Bears fullback Craig Goodman with 8 attempts, 17 yards, a 2.1 yard average, 2 touchdowns, as well as 2 receptions for 12 yards. In the AFC Defensive Rookie of the Year race, we have Chiefs right end Perry Benedict with 18 tackles, 11 solo, 4 tackles for loss, 6.5 sacks. Bills strong safety DeAndre Jeffries with 25 tackles, 18 solo, 4 tackle for loss, 2 sacks, and 1 forced fumble. Titans right end Bryson Callahan with 19 tackles, 8 solo, 7 tackles for loss, 2 sacks. Raiders right end Emmanuel Melvin with 14 tackles, 6 solo, 2 tackle for loss, and 2.5 sacks. Colts left end Henry Scroggins with 16 tackles, 8 solo, 4 tackle for loss, and 0 sacks. Broncos right end Jaden Parsons with 11 tackles, 7 solo, 3 tackle for loss, 1 sack. Ravens left end Ashton Horn, 10 tackles, 5 solo, 4 for a loss, 1 sack. Colts right end Jared Leonard with 11 tackles, 8 solo, 2 tackle for loss, and 0 sacks. Texans left end Alfonso Levy with 3 tackles, 3 solo, 1 tackle for loss, and 1 sack. And in last place, Bengals right end Neil Rutledge with 5 tackles, 1 solo, 3 tackle for loss, and no sacks. On the NFC side of things, the Bucks right side linebacker Marcus Cherry has 22 tackles, 14 solo, 7 tackle for loss with 3 sacks. Eagles free safety Delroy Harvey has 32 tackles, 19 solo, 1 tackle for loss and 2 interceptions. Redskins right side linebacker Cornell Perry has 14 tackles, 9 solo, 3 tackle for a loss, 3.5 sacks and 1 interception. Eagles left side linebacker Anton Mays has 34 tackles, 19 solo, 6 tackle for loss and 1 sack. Seahawks strong safety Jordan Whittaker has 27 tackles, 19 solo, 2 tackle for loss, and 1 sack. The Panthers defensive tackle Aaron Wallace has 12 tackles, 7 solo, 5 tackle for loss, and 3 sacks. Cowboys free safety Vaughn Bryant has 28 tackles, 19 solo, 1 tackle for loss, and 1.5 sacks. Redskins strong safety Lonnie Hodges has 10 tackles, 5 solo, 3 tackle for a loss, 1 sack, and 1 interception. 49ers cornerback Emmanuel Sands has 29 tackles, 21 solo, no sacks or interceptions. Seahawks right end D'Angelo Gunter has 11 tackles, 5 solo, and 3 sacks. Also, I have here some notable rookies. All offensive linemen. Not many rookie offensive linemen get the credit they deserve, so here they are. Ravens center Jared Fisaro, 10 games, 429 downs played, and only 1 sack allowed. Bengals right tackle Isaiah Hitchcock with 10 games played, 351 downs, and only 1 sack allowed. Redskins right tackle Jeffrey Trent with 10 games played, 360 downs, and 3 sacks allowed. And Lions left guard Tevin Rice out of Oklahoma State with 10 games played, 317 downs, and only 3 sacks allowed. One thing stuck out pretty blatantly to me, and that is the AFC offensive rookies have far outdone the NFC offensive rookies, and the NFC defensive rookies have outdone the AFC defensive rookies. I mean, look at the Chiefs wide receiver Ron Walters with almost 1,200 yards and 10 touchdowns in his rookie year, and the Jets' Harmon Bentley replacing the aging Le'Veon Bell with almost 650 yards, 11 touchdowns, and dangerous receiving out of the backfield with almost 300 yards and 2 touchdowns. These are definitely some players to be watching out for in the coming season. It's always fun to see how these rookies get drafted to MBL teams and watch them develop throughout the cycle, and who might get a bid for the MBL Players Hall of Fame. But that is still a long ways away, and anything can happen between now and then. We will revisit these rookies again at the end of the season to see who won each award. Personally, I think the Chiefs will walk away with two rookies of the year. Now, on to our third and final timeout of the show. For our last timeout, I want to go over the league as it stands with only 6 weeks left in the season. Right now in the MBL, we have one unbeaten team and one team that is still winless. The Ravens sit atop the pile at 10-0, while the Colts are struggling at 0-10, and everyone else is somewhere in between. The AFC playoff race, we have the 1 seed as the 10-0 Ravens, the 2 seed with the 9-1 Patriots, the 3 seed is the 8-2 Texans, the 4th seed is the 8-2 Chiefs, the 5th seed is the 7-3 Jets, and the 6th seed is the 6-4 Bengals, with the 6-4 Chargers and the 6-4 Titans right on their heels. In the NFC playoff race, we have the 9-1 Panthers in the 1st seed, in the 2nd seed we have the 8-2 Vikings, in the 3rd seed we have the 7-3 Seahawks, in the 4th seed we have the 7-3 Redskins, in the 5th seed we have the 7-3 Falcons, and in the 6th seed we have the 6-4 Cardinals, with the Bucks, Packers, Lions, and Cowboys all trailing at 5-5. The NFC playoff race is very tight. I think the Panthers will stay in the first seed, but the Vikings could give them a run for their money as their season comes to a close. The 3rd seed through the 6th seed will likely move all around as the season ends. It'll be interesting to see if the Cardinals squeeze into the playoffs, as they have a tough remaining schedule and 4 teams trailing behind them that all want in. In the AFC playoff race, I really only see one spot possibly moving around, and that is the 6th seed. The other 5 teams are rather firmly planted in their positions, barring any craziness. But we will have to wait and see how the rest of the season plays out to see who all makes it into the playoffs to fight to become MBL champion. Well, that about wraps it up for this episode of Timeout. I'm your host, Gibbs. I hope you guys enjoyed the show. Leave me a comment down below. I do check them, or hit me in the DMs, and I will catch you during the next Timeout.